Sweden, now officially a member of NATO, 2 years after Russia's invasion of Ukraine forced the Scandinavian nation to rethink its national security policy. Swedish Prime Minister Ulf Kristersson handed over the final documents to the U.S. government Thursday, the final step in a lengthy process of joining the military alliance. For Kristersson, joining NATO is the best guarantee of security.
It is a major step, but it's a very natural step. It's a kind of, we actually, in a literal sense, made Sweden safer and more secure. It was very eye-opening that what Russia actually did and have been doing for quite some time against Ukraine, that could actually happen to any independent democracy in Europe. Had Ukraine been a part of NATO, the Russians simply couldn't have invaded Ukraine. So,
for NATO, the accession of Sweden and Finland, which shares a 1,340-kilometer border with Russia, is the most significant development in decades. It is also a blow to Russian President Vladimir Putin, who has sought to prevent any further strengthening of the alliance. The U.S. set to build a temporary port in Gaza's Mediterranean coast for the delivery of humanitarian aid by sea. The plan is expected to be announced by U.S. President Joe Biden during his upcoming State of the Union speech. The emergency mission will be led by U.S. military. But senior U.S. officials say no military personnel will be deployed in Gaza. Washington's move follows warnings from the United Nations of a widespread famine in Gaza. The facility would accommodate large ships carrying food, water, medical supplies, and even temporary shelters. While Israel is increasing the number of aid trucks followed into the besieged enclave, the U.S. and other countries have been airdropping supplies into Gaza. But the amount of aid remains insufficient. Despite growing international pressure, Israel vows to continue with its offensive against Hamas. That's according to Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. He says even the southern Gaza city of Rafah won't be spared from Israel's retaliation.
When the international pressure rises, we must close ranks. We need to stand together against the attempts to stop the war. The Israeli military will continue to operate against Hamas in all of the Gaza Strip, including in Rafah, Hamas's final stronghold. Whoever tells us not to act in Rafah is telling us to lose the war, and that will not happen.
As the war enters its sixth month, families of hostages held by Hamas continue to demand action from the Israeli government to continue on the release, on the release of their loved ones.
We haven't seen a desire to bring about the release of more hostages. So we are very concerned that although they're saying that the hostages are very important, in reality, it doesn't look like, based on their action, that it's a high enough priority. And 5 months went by, many hostages died during this time, and it's simply unacceptable.
Israel said Hamas militants killed 1,200 and abducted 253 people when it stormed the country on October 7th. The response was a military assault on Gaza that has killed more than 30,800 to date. A Houthi missile attack kills two Filipino sailors in the Gulf of Aden. The attack on the Greek ship operated seriously injured three other crew members. This report.
Two Filipinos are among three seafarers confirmed dead in a Houthi missile attack on a bulk carrier navigating the Gulf of Aden. Foreign Affairs Undersecretary Eduardo de Vega said the crew of the MV True Confidence was forced to abandon ship after it was engulfed in flames. Three other Filipino crew members who were injured in the attack are now being treated in a hospital in Djibouti. The vessel's 20-man crew was composed of 15 Filipinos, 4 Vietnamese, and 1 Indian national.
There are 3 injured Filipinos. We know one has burns on the face. And the other, apparently, I think it was the cook, had to be amputated. That's injuries. They're in the Djibouti hospital now. in Tatlo and the other Filipinos.
The Philippine Embassy in Cairo will be sending representatives to facilitate the repatriation of 10 uninjured Filipino sailors.
The Philippine Embassy in Cairo is in charge of Djibouti. They'll have to send a team to work coordinated with, because ngayon wala silang papeles kasi sa rush, or maybe because the ship was burning, no? They left their papers.
The Philippine Migrant Workers Department did not disclose the names of the seafarers for privacy reasons, but it vowed to provide assistance to the families of the victims. It also reiterated its call for ship owners to avoid high-risk areas, particularly the Gulf of Aden and the Red Sea, where Houthi rebels have concentrated their maritime attacks. Philippine Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri condemned the deadly attack. He called it an act of terrorism, adding there is no justification for this brutality. These are the first fatalities reported since the Iran-aligned Yemeni group began strikes against ships passing through one of the world's busiest trade lanes. The U.S. State Department vows to hold the Houthis accountable.
The Houthis have continued to launch these reckless attacks with no regard for the well-being of innocent civilians who are transiting through the Red Sea. And now they have unfortunately and tragically killed innocent civilians. And so the United States will continue to hold the Houthis accountable for their attacks, which have not just disrupted international commerce, not just disrupted the freedom of navigation in international waters, and not just endangered seafarers, but now tragically killed a number of them. So we will continue to hold them accountable, and we call on governments around the world to do the same.
A spokesperson for the Houthi military said the vessel was attacked after it ignored warning messages from the Yemeni naval forces. In November last year, Houthi rebels seized the commercial vessel Galaxy Leader with 25 crew members on board. 17 of them are Filipinos. They are still being held hostage in Yemen.
11 Filipino crew members of a ship seized in January by the Iranian Navy are expected to return to the Philippines. This would leave 6 Filipinos aboard the St. Nicholas after one of its Filipino crew members was released last month. The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department expects the remaining crew to soon leave their posts as well. Iran's Navy seized the St. Nicholas after the U.S. allegedly stole Iranian oil.
11 sa kanila pinalitan na ng tripulante ng ibang bansa kasi yun ang demand natin, hindi other Filipinos, no? At papauwi na kasi nag-expire na yung contract. Itong linggo may darating na siyam, tapos next week may dalawa pa.
Washington firing back at China over its latest act of aggression in the West Philippine Sea. The U.S. State Department says China's maritime actions are deeply unacceptable and destabilizing. Despite Beijing's warning, Washington also asserts it will maintain its presence in the region.
The United States continues through our own operations to be physically present in the region on a daily basis, and we continue to fly, sail, and operate everywhere that international law allows, demonstrating thereby that all countries share those same rights.
Earlier this week, Chinese vessels fired water cannon and collided with Philippine ships off a Union shoal. The incident injured 4 Philippine Navy personnel. A Philippine vessel was also damaged.
Nothing major yung repair, only the replacement of yung windshield, madali lang naman yan. And then yung mga CCTV cameras na nasira, madali din naman palitan yan. Mabuti na kalagayan nila, sabi ko nga, minor injuries lang naman yan, na pa-check na namin sa station hospital namin dito sa Wesco. Minor din naman yung mga cuts nila. Sa mga braso, hindi naman sa delikadong lugar yun.
As of Thursday, only 3 Chinese vessels were monitored near Ayungin Shoal, down from 26 last Tuesday. legal trouble mounts for controversial Pastor Apollo Quiboloy. A U.S. federal judge on Thursday ordered the unsealing of the arrest warrant and first superseding indictment against the Kingdom of Jesus Christ leader. This means any authorized U.S. officer can now arrest Quiboloy for alleged offenses including sex trafficking, fraud, and bulk cash smuggling. Meanwhile, here at home, Quiboloy is getting more backers in the Senate. Senators Robin Padilla, Amy Marcos, Cynthia Villar, and Christopher Goh have signed the written objection meant to overturn Quiboloy's contempt order for snubbing Senate hearings.
Kaibigan ko si Pastor Quiboloy, mabait siya sa aming pamilya. At natataka ko din sa ano na yan, case na yan. Kaya medyo hindi ako masyado naniniwala sa case na yan.
They have rights to due process. They have a right to defend themselves and against self-incrimination.
Senator J.V. Ejercito initially objected to the contempt order, but later withdrew his signature. Padilla's group has at least 4 days to complete the 8 signatures needed to junk the contempt ruling.
May mga nakausap na ako na sa mga napakagandang paliwanag nila, tinatanggap ko naman na hindi sila pumirma. At yun yung mga bagay na ikinatutuwa at ikinalulungkot. Kasi siyempre, ikinatuwa dahil buhay ang demokrasya sa Senado. Nalulungkot dahil hindi ko pa nakukuha yung 8 boto hanggang sa ngayon.
Philippine transport authorities begin drilling for another station of the nearly 500 billion peso Metro Manila subway. But as Andrea Tiguinas tells us, right-of-way issues continue to hound the project.
30 feet below this construction site, the excavation for another station of the 488 billion peso Metro Manila subway project has officially commenced. Department of Transportation Secretary Jaime Bautista led Thursday's site inspection, more than a week after his agency also gave members of the media a glimpse of the ongoing construction work over at the Valenzuela station.
These are the two tunnel boring machines that have begun drilling operations to make way for the North Avenue subway station here in Quezon City. The DOTR expects to finish the tunneling from here to the East Valenzuela station in 12 months or by March 2025. But for the entire Metro Manila subway project, the target completion date is still a bit far off, or in 2029.
That's as right-of-way issues continue to hound the project, which will span 17 stations from Valenzuela City to Bicutan in Parañaque, with a branch line to Naia Terminal 3 in Pasay City. Bautista admitted the awarding of the three remaining contract packages for the subway was moved to the third quarter of this year, since negotiations with affected landowners and property holders are still underway. The DOTR initially aimed to have contract packages 105, 108, and 109 awarded in 2023.
Siguraduhin muna natin na yung right-of-way natin ay makuha, no? Kasi ang magiging problema natin if we enter into a contract with the contractor, no? And then yung may mga issues pa tayo sa right-of-way, baka hindi makapagsimula on time, no? And magkaroon ng tinatawag na prolongation cost.
According to Bautista, they have encountered problems negotiating with both the private sector and even some government agencies.
Yung isang station natin ay may tatamaan na isang building, no, na pag-aari ng Department of Education, no, and that building is considered a heritage site, cultural property, no, and kailangan ayusin natin paano natin maililipat yung building or posibleng ilipat din yung station.
There are also homeowners who are concerned about having a subway constructed beneath their property. But the DOTR gave this guarantee.
Yung kanilang mga pag-aari, yung kanilang mga bahay will continue to be safe, no? During the construction and during the operation of the subway. We're using Japanese technology. Subok na yan, no? Wala namang naging problema yung mga tunnel or yung mga subway na ginawa sa Japan.
So far, the government has only acquired 55% of the properties needed for the project. But Bautista assured the public the subway can be finished by 2029. So what happens if negotiations with landowners reach an impasse? DOTR Undersecretary Jeremy Rijino said only then will they resort to expropriation.
If there will be no agreement, then we will have to file the expropriation proceedings, but without prejudice to continuing with the negotiations.
Rijino also vowed just compensation for those whose property will be affected by the subway. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. and First Lady Liza Araneta Marcos invited to Germany for a working visit next week. They have also received a similar invitation for a state visit to the Czech Republic. The successive visits will take place from March 11 to 15. In Berlin, the president will meet German Chancellor Olaf Scholz, while in the Czech Republic, he will meet with four heads of government. The talks seek to strengthen bilateral relations and foster increased cooperation. The president will also speak to prominent business leaders and will have the opportunity to meet with Filipino communities in the Central European countries. Donald Trump giving an advance rebuttal to U.S. President Joe Biden's State of the Union address. In a video released on his Truth Social site, Trump blamed Biden for what he called a horror show of illegal migration to the country. The former president also calling his successor a feeble leader.
The country, our country, is being laughed at all over the world. Over the past 3 years, Biden has actively aided and abetted the importation of millions and millions of illegal alien migrants and resettled them into your communities. It's the sight of a feeble Joe Biden talking about shrinkflation, the term he uses, is one of the most ridiculous things this country has ever seen. Shrinkflation is just another way of saying inflation. It means that you're losing a lot of money because these people don't know what they're doing. It was all caused by crooked Joe Biden and the people that surround him.
Biden is expected to use his last State of the Union address before the election to sharpen distinctions with Trump on the economy and to try to ease voter concerns about his age and the Gaza war. Opinion polls show Biden and Trump closely matched in the race. Most American voters, though, are not enthusiastic about the rematch. Meanwhile, in preparation for his speech, Biden sought advice from some of the most memorable presidents on the big and small screen. Among the attendees on the video Zoom call, Morgan Freeman, Michael Douglas, Tony Goldwyn, Bill Pullman, and Gina Davis.
My advice is just keep telling us how you're working for us and building hope.
Tell them that you exist for them. Tell them that they make you a better man.
We can't be consumed by our petty differences, and we will be united in our common interests.